Okay, we begin a new segment of the Hidden Structures series. We will be looking at group actions and CMA structures. Now, regarding group actions, I will be assuming that you have seen this idea before, and what I provide here is really just a quick overview of the principal definitions and a number of classic examples. This in no way is meant to teach these ideas for the first time. Now, when we get to CMA structures, that is a new idea, and that one we will cover in great detail because this, to my knowledge, has never been presented before. Okay, so this is original work here. Okay, I thought it interesting to quote 2 Nephi 2:14. This is Lehi speaking, in which he says, both things to act and things to be acted upon. And I thought this is a perfect description of groups and group actions. Groups are the things that act. The sets of objects are the things that groups will act upon. So, to relate it to the kinds of things that we have been doing, in the many examples that we have provided using an ordinary packet of cards, the structure of the cards is what is being acted upon by our shuffles, which are group elements. These are permutations that we've been applying. So both of these concepts are essential. You have to have things that act, that bring about change in some way, and things to be acted upon, such as the physical world around us, or in our case, a packet of cards endowed with a desired structure. Okay? Okay, the definition of a group action. An action of a group G on a set X is the choice for each little g and big G of a permutation pi sub G from X to X such that the following two conditions hold. Pi sub E is the identity element in our group G. Pi sub E is the identity, in some sense, on our group of objects. So pi sub e of x needs to be equal to x for each x in our set capital X. Number two, for every pair of group elements in G, so G1, G2, it needs to be the case that the permutation associated with G1 composed with the permutation associated with G2 be equal to the permutation associated with G1, G2. Okay? So here's an example. Let Sn, this is the symmetric group on n letters, or you can think of it as the n numbers, 1 through n. Let Sn act on this set of values in the usual way. Okay, so all that means then is the permutation associated with a permutation from the symmetric group will be defined in terms of the output of the permutation from the symmetric group evaluated at that input I. So, as we'll see, quite often the notation, though highly precise, can obscure what's going on. And so once we work many examples over the next few class periods, the notation will become much easier to decipher. Okay, so just hang in there. Second example, each group G acts on itself. That's interesting. So remember, a group is a set of things on which we have a binary operation. It's closed under that operation. It has an identity element, often referred to as E. It has the associative property. It has inverses. Okay. So each group is a set of things with this operation, binary operation defined. So what we're doing here is we're just stripping the group G of its algebraic structure and focusing just on the elements of G itself as just ordinary set elements, okay? So each group G acts on itself, so our X, our set of objects, will just be G itself, by left multiplication functions, okay? So that is, we set pi sub G, goes from capital G to capital G, by this, pi sub G of H, okay? So the permutation associated with the group element G can be defined as, given an input H, to get the output, you just take G and then, quote, multiply it by H, whatever the group operation is. And you do that for all G and H and G, okay? This is another one that will become clear as we actually go to apply it. Then the condition for being a group action are EH is equal to H for all H, and G1, and then parentheses, G2H is equal to parentheses, G1, G2, and then H on the outside for all G1, G2, and H and G, which are both true since E is an identity and multiplication in G is associative. And in fact, this is the very essence of Cayley's theorem. You remember looking at that, in which Cayley proved that every finite group is isomorphic to a subgroup of some symmetric group for some n, okay? In practice, we dispense with the notation pi sub g and write pi sub g of x simply as g dot x or gx. This is not meant to be an actual multiplication of elements from two possibly different sets g and x. It is just the notation for the effect of g. Actually, the permutation G is associated to, on the element X. In this notation, the axioms for a group action become, number one, for each X in big X, E dot X is equal to X. For every G1, G2, and G, and X and X, we get G1 dot, and then parentheses, G2 dot, X is equal to parentheses G1 G2 dot X. Okay, so it's important to know where we are, where each of these elements lives. Okay, so once again, this dot is representing the group action operation. Okay, it's not multiplication in the ordinary sense here. Okay, so when you take a group element and you act upon an element from your set, you get another element in your set, X. So this is actually an element of the set X. Now, if we act upon that element by way of another group element, G1, then we will still get, it'll be likely a different element of X, but we will stay in the set X. Over here, what's different? G1, G2, that is representing a product in your group structure. So in your group, there'll be some kind of binary operation defined. G1, G2 is referring to the binary operation of G with inputs G1 and G2. So this is an element of G, and now that element is going to act on our set element X. And so in the end, we do get an element in our set X, okay? So you may want to pause the video and kind of think about where these different elements live at different stages in that list of operations. The basic idea in a group action is that the elements of a group are viewed as permutations of a set in such a way that composition of the corresponding permutations matches multiplication in the original group. So you can think about it as you have a group that has a binary operation defined, so there's algebraic structure, if you want to phrase it that way, and then you have a set of objects on which there's no binary operation defined, and now you're going to use the algebraic structure of your group and impose it in a very special way on the elements of your ordinary set. So the group is acting on the set of objects X. Okay, so here's another example. For n larger than or equal to 3, each element of the group dn acts as a rigid motion of a regular n-gon in the plane, either a rotation or a reflection. We can also view dn as acting just on the vertices of a regular n-gon. Knowing where the vertices go determine the rest of the rigid motion. So the effect of dn on the vertices tells us all we need to know to determine the rigid action on the n-gon. Okay? Restricting the action of dn from an n-gon to its vertices and labeling the vertices as 1 through n in some manner makes dn act on the set 1 through n. Okay? Definition. A group action of G on X is called faithful if different elements of G act on X in different ways. In other words, when G1 is not equal to G2, there is an X in your set such that G1 dot X is not equal to G2 dot X. Note that when we say G1 and G2 act differently, we mean they act differently somewhere, not necessarily everywhere. Just like when we talk about two functions not being the same, well, that just means that there's at least one input where those two functions give you different outputs. That's all it's saying. Example, the action of G on itself by left multiplication is faithful. Different elements send the identity element to different places. Okay, and related to group actions are the important concepts of orbit and stabilizer. Okay, and so we'll see this. We'll be using these next time in class, but I thought we would just remind the student and the viewer of the definition of both of these terms. The information encoded in a group action has two basic parts. One part tells us where points go, and the other part tells us how points stay put. The following terminology refers to these ideas. Definition, let a group G act on a set X. For each X in big X, its orbit is, and it's represented this way, it's essentially all of the elements in the set X that can be reached by way of the elements of our group G. When we allow those elements to act on the elements of the group X, okay? And its stabilizer is notated this way. And now this is And maybe, excuse me, let me just back up here. It's important to know this is a set that has only elements of X in it. So this is going to be, this is a subset, could be the whole thing. This is a subset of our set of objects. Okay. Now the stabilizer is actually a subgroup of our group. Okay. So this time the stabilizer is actually, in terms of a set, it's actually a subset, as well as a subgroup, subset of our group G. Okay. So just be clear on the differences. These are members of the set X, and these are members of the set G, the group G. Okay, so a stabilizer is all elements in our group that hold that particular X fixed. And boy, will this be an important one in the study of cyclic and mirrored structures. The stabilizer of X is often denoted by G sub X in the literature, where G is the group. Okay? Example, when a group G acts on itself by left multiplication, there is one orbit, namely the orbit of the identity element E gives you the entire set of objects. You have to remember we're allowing G to act on itself. It means that we're allowing our set of objects to actually be G. And so here we are ignoring the fact that, quote, it's a group, that it has a binary operation. We're only focused on the elements that make up that group. We don't care about the structure right now. Okay, so here's the group, and here is just the set of objects that make up the group with the algebraic structure stripped away or ignored, okay? So you have to realize that this here will be, as I just mentioned, these will be elements in our ordinary set. Well, we're allowing G to act on itself. So our ordinary set X is G in terms of what elements make up that set. Okay, so we actually do get G. But the thing to think about here is, think about just the elements in G and ignore any structure, algebraic structure that we've put on that, okay? Now, the stabilizer, on the other hand, will just be the trivial subgroup. It just has the identity in it. That's all it has, just the identity, okay? And the reason it has just the identity is because of the requirement for the stabilizer. It's all elements in our group G that hold a particular X value fixed. Well, these little X values are actually also elements of the group G as a set. Well, the only element G that's going to fix X, meaning leave it alone, is the identity. The identity is that unique element that behaves this way. Okay, great. And now you may see something else that's kind of interesting. So here we got the entire set of objects that make up the group. Here we just got the identity element from the group. Okay. Now, this, if you are seeing what I'm trying to point out here, you'll realize it's an illustration of this fact down here that we'll look at in just a minute. I guess I skipped number three. There are no fixed points if the order of the group G is larger than one. So let me just remind you, the vertical bars is referring to cardinality, how many objects are in the set, okay? So if the group is larger than one, so in other words, two or larger, there won't be any fixed points. So the orbit stabilizer theorem, and here I've just called it the formula, which is sometimes the case, is the following. The order of the group, so the number of elements in the group, is equal to the number of objects in the orbit and the number of elements in the stabilizer subgroup. Okay, so this order will always be the product of those two, and we'll see an example of that in a few minutes. We call x a fixed point for an action when g dot x is equal to x for every g in our group. In other words, we are requiring that the orbit of x just be the singleton set here. The only thing in the orbit of x is x. And that's for the simple reason that all of the elements in g leave x fixed, leave x alone. So you don't get any additional, quote, points from acting on x by elements in g. Or equivalently, when the stabilizer of x is in fact equal to the whole group g. Okay, so remember, we're looking at a fixed point. Well, a fixed point is where every element in the group leaves that point alone. Well, that's what the stabilizer is, right? If you remember, the stabilizer is right here. The stabilizer is the set of all elements in our group that leave a particular x value the same or fixed. Okay, and so that if x is a fixed point, then this would have to be the entire group. Okay, so here's some context for the definitions of orbit and stabilizer. So this will kind of explain, you know, why these names were given early on, because they sound a bit strange at first. The idea of the orbit of a point is a geometric concept. So if you go back to the etymology of the word as used here, it's a geometric concept. It is the set of all places or locations where the point can be moved by the group action. Okay? Whereas the stabilizer of a point is an algebraic concept. It is the set of group elements that fix the point. Okay, so you can see that both of these ideas are going to be of value to us. If you think about some of the kinds of problems that we've tackled, this one, of course, the stabilizer is looking at what things are fixed, what things are unchanged, right? And that was one of the key concepts for symmetry, right? Symmetry means that you can have a distinction without a difference. Okay, so in some sense, there's a kind of a fixed point requirement, right, embedded in the idea of symmetry. And the stabilizer is literally the set of group elements that fix a particular element from your set of objects. Okay, and then the orbit essentially means, given a point in your set, when you apply all of the different group elements to it, where is that point moved to? Okay, so does it stay where it is, or does it get moved to another location? Another location for us will refer to another configuration of the cards, actually. Okay, in general, the elements of the set X are referred to as points. Okay, so that's kind of how they use it. They use that term in like topology or geometry. Okay, so that was a bit heavy. So that was a kind of a quick review of the essential definitions that we will need moving forward in our study of cyclic and mirrored structures. These next two concepts, I don't believe, will be as difficult to grasp and make sense of, and we will be practicing during our class time today, and hopefully by the time we finish class, you'll be feeling comfortable with these ideas, and these are in fact essential ideas moving forward. Okay, so the first one's called a CMA sequence, and the next one's called a CMA structure, okay? Okay, so informally, a CMA sequence is a sequence of 2m zeros, so an even number of zeros, and the same even number of ones, satisfying the following, okay? So this is what it takes to be a CMA sequence. It needs to be the case that this sequence is a two-cycle relative to either identical values or opposite values. Okay? So identical values just are referring to the value, you know, like one is identical with itself, the ones are identical with other ones, and the zeros are identical to other zeros. And then we'll say a zero and one are opposites of each other. So here we're just looking at two values, a zero or a one. Okay, so it's a dichotomous outcome of zero or one. A CMA sequence needs to satisfy that. It also needs to satisfy this. It is mirrored relative to either identical or opposite values. It also needs to be the case that this sequence is an AMP relative to either identical or opposite values. Now, I don't really know if I needed to include this degenerate case, it's called. I just think it's interesting that it technically gives CMA sequences. I personally think it's really kind of cool that it works, even with 1-0 and 1-1. Okay, so using just 1-0 and 1-1, there are two CMA sequences. The first one is 1, 0, and the second one, 0, 1. What does that tell us? So I have down here, verify that both of these sequences are two cycles, mirrored, and AMPs relative to opposite values. Okay, so why don't we just focus, and maybe this is clear, maybe I don't need to show this to you, but so just think about this, a sequence, and think about what we've been doing. If you want to think about this as red and then black, you have a red and a black card. So is that a two cycle? And if so, relative to what categorical relation? Well, for it to be a two cycle, we have to have P equivalent values or cards be C equivalent. Okay. So our C equivalence here is that they have opposite value. We've done that before where things are of opposite color. That was our categorical relation. So this is actually a two cycle, an actual two cycle relative to opposite values, right? So is this mirrored? Is it an AMP? Well, what's needed for it to be mirrored? It needs to be that values from either end, as you move in towards the center, kind of equal distance as you move, those values need to be C equivalent. Well, C equivalence here, we're claiming, is that they have opposite value. Is it true that these have the opposite value when you view it as a mirrored structure? Sure, of course it is. What about an AMP? What's needed for an AMP? AMP is where you take things as pairs, right? You kind of move down the sequence. Well, there's only two. So is that there's only one pair. So is that pair an AMP relative to opposite values? Yes. So believe it or not, even this degenerate case ends up giving us CMA sequences. Okay, but much more interesting will be if we have more values to work with, okay? So now we're getting to something where we have a bit more to talk about. Okay, example two, m is equal to 1. Okay, so remember, we need 2m zeros and 2m ones. Okay, so here we would need two zeros and two ones. Okay, so there are six CMA sequences. And I've arranged them in a very important way, as we'll see. Okay, are there any others? Let's kind of think through this. Now, I created these for us. I probably should have had us do this together, actually, this part, but we're going to be doing an even harder one together, I suppose. So, okay, so we have, so you want to think about it this way. These are the values we can use, okay? Well, if you look at the requirements for a two cycle, what needs to be the case? In fact, I'm going to go ahead and do something that we will very shortly be doing right there because it's just a helpful way to represent these. It just makes it easier for us to focus on the fundamental structure of the sequence. Okay, so think about it. Is it possible to create a two cycle relative to either identical values? So that would be your categorical relation, that p-equivalent cards would be c-equivalent, and c-equivalence here would mean that they have the same value, okay? Well, is that possible? Well, yeah, of course it is. You could have like one, and then remember, let me just write it off to the side so we know what we're talking about, right? So two cycles, okay? So if I put a one here, I'm trying to build two cycles using just those. And I'm free to choose either a categorical relation of equivalent values or opposite values. Either one of those will be acceptable for a CMA structure. Okay, so if I put a one here, well, I have to put a one. Well, I don't have to, but if I put a one in the p equivalent position over here, I am saying that C equivalent values have to be the same. You can't have a mixture, okay? I guess that's pretty important to clarify here. So C equivalent values are identical. They need to be the same. Okay, so if I put a 1 and a 1 here, well, that I only have two other elements. So 0 would have to go there, and 0 would have to go there. Okay, so this is a two cycle relative to the values being identical, being the same. Okay, are there other two cycles? Well, it ends up that once you have a two cycle, the inversion or complement, those are some words we'll define in just a minute, will also be a two cycle relative to the same categorical relation. Well, what's an inversion or a complement? Well, that's where you look at, you're given a sequence. Here it's a two cycle. And you replace the ones with zeros and the zeros with ones. That's all that means. So if I put a zero here, a one, and then we put the bar again if we want, and then a zero, and then a one, these are called complements. Those two are complements of each other, or they are the inversion of each other. Okay, but is this a two cycle relative to the categorical relation of the values being equal or being identical? Well, it is, right? Because we're looking at a two cycle, so p equivalent positions are right here. They have numbers in them of the same value. These are p equivalent positions. They have numbers in them of the same value, okay? Great. Any others? What other two cycles could we make? Well, you can kind of look up here, I guess. So we could do, so let's go through, and maybe we won't find all of these now because we're going to get more practice in a minute. But, this was relative to identical values, okay? How about relative to opposite values? So we're still looking, let me write this down. We're still looking at a two cycle structures is what we're wanting. Okay, so relative to opposite values, I would put a zero here. And then over here, you actually have some choices, right? So I could put a one here, Maybe I was I going to try to try to generate that one there. I could put a zero here, and then for it to be a two cycle relative to opposite values, of course I'd have to put a one there. And also, those are the only values I have. Okay, so this would be a two cycle relative to opposite values. Opposite values. Okay. Now let me just explain, because you might be wondering, okay, why are we even looking at this idea of CMA sequences? Well, it will become clear soon, and you may have already made some connections with things that we've done in the past. These CMA sequences give rise to a treasure trove of invariant structures. Now, is this the only two cycle relative to opposite values? Well, no, because we can go with the inversion here, right? The complement. That one right there. Okay, and so that will also have the same property of being a two cycle relative to opposite value. Okay, now that is just focusing on the two cycle structure. Okay, now we need it to not only be a two cycle relative to either the same or opposite values, but simultaneously it needs to also be mirrored and an AMP relative to either the same or opposite values. Okay, so I guess I should point out that it can be a two cycle relative to, let's say, the same values, but then be mirrored relative to the opposite values. Okay, that is permissible. Okay, so it doesn't have to be the case that all three, it's relative to the same values, let's say. Let's just check this for its mirrored structure. So here, those are mirrored positions. Those are mirrored positions. Well, they end up having values in those positions that are opposite. Okay, same thing here. So this is actually mirrored relative to values not being equal, right? So relative to opposite values. And here we have a mirrored structure relative to values being the same. Okay, so these are mirrored positions, and we have the same value in each of those. The same thing here. Mirrored positions that have the same value placed there, a zero and a zero. Okay. Okay, and then an AMP. What is this? How would we describe this as an AMP? Well, that's where you take them in pairs. Those are the opposite values. Those are the opposite. So it's the AMP relative to opposite. Same thing here. Okay. Now, what's going to happen, and it's probably just right on the next page here. So it won't hurt to see this idea more than once. So what we will be doing, and it's a wonderful way to compress a lot of information into just a few letters, actually. Okay, so CMA, so remember the C comes first. So what we said here, as a two cycle, the C equivalent values are identical. So what that would mean then is it's a two cycle relative to the same values being in those P equivalent positions. And then what did we find out for this sequence as a mirrored sequence? It's mirrored relative to opposite values. And then it's an AMP relative to opposite values. Okay, so that is how we are going to summarize the properties that this either one of these sequences actually have. And it will be the case here for sequences of size 4 that they'll come in pairs, just as we've seen here. Okay, so we would say that this, either one of these sequences, it has an SOO structure. OK, Okay, so when we talk about an SMA sequence, it's referring to, for instance, that. When we talk about a CMA structure, we're talking about this. Okay, so the structure is really just a summary of what's happening in that sequence relative to two-cycle mirrored and AMP structures. Okay, so maybe for practice, let's do this one down here. Now, that's a two-cycle relative to opposite values. Let me just write this down one more time here so that MA, you know, just so you can, you know, once you get CMA down, you know, that you won't have to kind of write that to remind you what order to put these different S's and O's. So we've already noted that this is a two-cycle relative to opposite values. And I was going to write it down wrong. Opposite values, sorry. It's mirrored relative to the same values, right? Same value, 1100. Excellent. And then it's an AMP relative to opposite values again. So this is an OSO CMA structure, okay? And you can maybe even note what's, even see what's going on with this last one. It looks like it's a two cycle relative to opposite values. And then it's mirrored relative to opposite values. And then it's an AMP relative to the same values. Okay, so that one would actually be OOS. So it's different than those two, right? So OOS, okay? And it ends up that there's only three CMA, oh, sorry, wrote down three. Sorry. Okay. There's only three CMA structures for these six CMA sequences. And they come in pairs here. And as we'll see, the CMA structure types partition the set of sequences into disjoint sets of the same size. Okay, so that's something that will come out. Okay, so now what I mentioned here is some notational conventions I've decided to use. It just makes things easier to work with and to recognize what you're seeing more readily. Okay, the first one is the commas in the CMA sequences are omitted. So normally when we write a sequence of things, we use commas, and there's many reasons for doing that, but one would be just to be clear on where one element ends and the next one begins, right? But these will just be sequences of zeros and ones. Those are the only values that we will be putting in, okay? So we do not need to put commas in to represent those. So what we're going to do is we're going to drop the commas. And in addition to that, we are going to use our vertical bar, which we've been using all semester, to mark the center of our sequence. And it really does help to see, okay, like right off, you can see that's a two cycle relative to values being the same, right? It's mirrored relative to values being opposite and so forth, okay? So anyway, this is eventually how we'll write things. And I've had this document up the whole time, so I apologize for that. But the fact is I haven't needed all of the document camera area. So some of what I've written over here is starting to look familiar, right? Just some of the symbols and things. And just to give you a peek at what we'll be doing next time, is we will be looking at the Klein 4 group, okay? So it's a group of order 4. And something that is really quite remarkable is that in the Klein four groups permutation representation. That just means we're representing the elements of the Klein four group as permutations. So this will be a subset of the S4, which is the symmetric group on four letters. It ends up that the elements of the Klein four group give rise to or are equivalent to some of the packet mixing procedures that we've been using, so some of the shuffles. So the first one is a pairwise transpose. The next one is a Charlier 1 or a 50% cut. And then the last one is a packet reversal. So with a packet of cards, you can represent the Klein 4 group. Now, look as you may, I don't believe you'll find anywhere where someone has done this. Okay? So we will be able to use something very tangible, namely a packet of four cards, to represent what's going on in the Klein 4 group. And equally importantly, we are going to discover some invariant structures, but this will just be the first very simple but important example of not only the connection of CMA structures to fundamental groups and group theory, but how we can use these important groups in very, very surprising and novel ways. Okay, so let's turn the page here. So finally, now some of this will be review now because I always seem to steal information from the future here. But so I talked about not only will we write down the CMA sequences, but we will also make note of their CMA structure, okay, as I'm doing right here. So this is actually a summary of what we started to do there. So again, using the six sequences from example two, we will group the sequences as before, but include their explicit CMA structure. So here they are. Okay, remember, these are complementary pairs, if you want to think about it that way, or they are inversions of one another within that group. Same thing there. And then here is the CMA structure clearly written out. Okay. And then over here, if you feel like you need further explanation as to okay, how do you interpret this, I've summarized it over here, even though I kind of explained it in words a minute ago. So S is for same values, O is for opposite values. And then SOO, it just means that our sequence is a two-cycle relative to same values. O here means it's mirrored relative to opposite values. And then over here, an O means it's an AMP relative to opposite values. Okay, so there's not much new to tell you there. Okay, great. So to be clear, regarding our new vocabulary, the six sequences in example two, those are the ones that we kind of started to write out ourselves, are referred to as CMA sequences. And the structure types, SOO, OSO, and OOS, are called CMA structures. Okay, so it'll be really helpful to have those two understood. So this is actually referring to the sequence of zeros and ones. And then CMA structure is referring to, okay, what kind of cyclic, mirrored, and AMP structure do those sequences have? Okay. Perfect. Moreover, a CMA sequence and its corresponding CMA structure are said to be of order for M if the CMA sequence has length for M. So for the examples that I was just doing, we would say here that that is a CMA sequence of order 4, because that has length 4, and that this CMA structure of order 4 or 8 or 16 or whatever it might be, is telling you how many elements are in the CMA sequence. And then over here, I've mentioned also the inversion or complement of a CMA sequence is obtained by simply replacing zeros with ones and ones with zeros. CMA structure type partitions the set of CMA sequences into disjoint sets of the same size. Okay, now that was the case in the example that we just gave. The six CMA sequences in that example uniquely fall into three distinct equal-sized classes. So remember, SOO had two sequences, OSO had two, and OOS had two sequences. Okay, so as a consequence of our previous observation, we can state that CMA structure type yields or produces an equivalence relation on the set of CMA sequences. Having equivalence classes of equal cardinality, so of equal size, or the number of elements. Now, I'm going to leave the proof of this assertion to the student or the viewer. It's not too difficult to show in general. Okay, and then as a final little activity, and for some additional practice, let's construct all of the CMA sequences and their corresponding CMA structures of order 8. To help guide us in our construction, I've listed all of the possible CMA structures except for one. Can you find the missing one? Okay, and I left it off on purpose, actually. but if I want you to find it, if you're interested. So if you want to try to find that other one, that would be great. That's the request here. Okay, so how would we find these CMA sequences that go with those structures? Now, there's not just one way to like jump in here and do it. I guess we could just work on the left and then move to the right. Okay, so we want it to be a two-cycle relative to same value. So if I put, let's say I put a 1 right here. Well, if it's going to be a two-cycle relative to same value, I have no choice. I have to put a 1 right there. So that's forced. Now, maybe it just as a reminder, I'll just do it down here. Okay, so this is what we're looking at. We have four zeros that we can choose. And in fact, we need to eventually choose all of them. And the same thing for four ones. Okay, so we have to use all of these. So I have two of the ones taken. Great. Okay, so let's say I put a 0 here. Okay. Now, I'm still focused on the two-cycle structure. Okay. So once, in fact, probably once you get that, well, no, I have to be careful. Okay. So if I put a 0 there, it's going to be a two-cycle relative to the same value. I have to have a 0 here. There's no choice. Okay, now technically I could put a 0 or 1 there, and that those different choices will lead to some other cases here, but I think I'm going to just put a 1 there for now. Well, for it to be a two-cycle relative to same value, I'd have to have a 1 there. Now, I've used up the 1s. The 1s are gone. I've used 4 of them. So there's no option. There's no choice except zeros right here. Now, the thing I don't know for sure is whether this falls into that category. So just be aware that the order in which you would do this sort of thing in real life is you would generate all of the CMA sequences that are possible. And then you would have to look at those and say, oh, okay, how do they group? And how do they group together? And what is their overall CMA structure? Okay. But because I put the structures as labels here, that's kind of having us do things a little bit backwards, unfortunately. Or I have to look ahead to see which one I should be putting here, which is really what I'm doing. But so once this one is down, we know that the inversion of that one will automatically have the same CMA structure type. So inversion just means you switch zeros for ones and ones for zeros, right? That's all. Okay, so here I have, I don't know, maybe we'll need to stop underlining them. It's just too much writing. So here I have two CMA sequences. The only thing I've checked so far for these two is that they are two cycles relative to the same value. But are they mirrored and AMPs relative to opposite value? Okay, well, we're going to find out that that's the case, right? Because if you focus on the mirrored structure here, so I'm looking at the end values, well, they're opposite values. And then as you move in, opposite, opposite, opposite. So essentially, I could say, okay, I've checked that. I know it's that now. Is it an AMP relative to opposite values? Well, it is. You get 1, 0, and then the next pair is 1, 0, the next pair, 1, 0. And the same thing down here, right? As an AMP, you take them in pairs. So you get 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and the values in those little pairs are opposite. Okay, so indeed, I have found two CMA sequences that have this CMA structure. Now, it ends up that these are all of them, as we'll find out, right? These are all of them, but we shouldn't assume that we know that up front, because as we go with bigger CMA sequences, you will not just be getting two in each category, you'll get more. I kind of apologize for the fact that maybe trying to organize things, I've tempted us to kind of work backwards a little bit. And, you know, really on a separate piece of paper, you could kind of puzzle this out. I mean, you could write down, okay, we want it to be a two-cycle relative to opposite value, mirrored relative to the same value, and AMP relative opposite value, okay? So if we kind of begin to, you know, build that like we did before, let's say we put a 1 right here. I suppose it really is helpful to have these little dashes. We want it to be a two-cycle relative to opposite values. So the P equivalent positions need to have opposite values in them. And then I guess we could actually just go through and, do this one as well. Kind of mimic some of what we're doing up there. So if I put a 0 there, yeah, because we're requiring something different, right, for the two cycle. So if I put a 0 there, I have to put a 1 right there, right? If I put, let's just continue with the 1, the 10, 10, I guess. If I put a 1 there, I have to put a 0 over here. Two cycle relative to opposite values. I have to put a 0 here because I've run out of 1s, right? Well, no, I haven't run out of 1s. I'm down to just a 0 and a 1. Sorry, I said that wrong. So 1 would have to go right there, okay? And then we can quickly check. Now, we've constructed it as a two-cycle relative to opposite values. Now, is it true that it's mirrored relative to the same values? Well, it is. Because here the n value and the n value over here, they're the same number, right? Same value. And as you come in, you get 0, 0, then 1, 1, 0, 0. So we've checked that and that. Is it an AMP relative to opposite values? Well, it is, right? Because you're going to look at those two. Their opposite values, those two, these two, and then these two, right? Opposite values. So indeed, it is an OSO structure. And then we can quickly get its companion or complementary partner by exchanging ones for zeros and vice versa. So we would get a 0, and then a 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. Right, and then we'll do that little Well, right there. Great. Okay, so there we go. That one's done. So I don't know if we need to do all of these. I think you could probably finish these on your own. Why don't we come over to this one here? It looks kind of interesting to have two S's in a row. In fact, maybe I should just assign that as a little exercise later to complete the last two on your own. Last two CMA structures. Okay, so let's say we start with one right there. Okay, so it has to be the same value, right, for the two cycle. Once again, we're kind of doing it backwards here. You write out all of the possibilities, and then you group them into categories. So sorry about that. Okay, so if I have zeros here, I guess in some ways you can kind of look ahead because so we're okay on the two-cycle front, but we also need it to be the case that it is the same relative to the mirrored values. So what you could do is if we want it mirrored as well, that would have to go there. This one would have to be that one. This one would have to be that one. And then this one would have to be a zero. And the forcing of those values has not upset our two-cycle structure where we wanted values to be the same, okay? So I don't know if that was helpful or not to go that route. But and then we do have this being satisfied. It is also mirrored relative to the same value. And then it is also an A and P relative to opposite values, right? So you get that one. Okay, then you can get the inversion. Okay, so next time we will look at the group actions of the Klein 4 group on these different CMA sequences. And which of the CMA structures are invariant under the Klein 4 group, okay? From there, we'll explore, okay, knowing what the invariant CMA structures are, how could you make use of that information, okay? Okay, well, great. So we'll see you in the next video.